So what we're going to do today in this video is just go through the real basics of sea fishing. I'm going to take it right back. So if you haven't sea fished before, if you're returning to the sport, course angler, fly angler that wants to try in the sea. We've had lots of questions come into the channel and a lot of those are based around the real basics of starting fishing from the beach. But as you can see, it's a big place out here. I have covered in the channel before as the rain starts to come down in November. We've covered in the channel before things like watercraft, all the different species you can catch, but I really want to take it back today. So perhaps even if you've fished before, there might be some reminders in there as well. It's actually been quite good for me to look back. So we'll go from the start. You turn up on the beach. There's lots of videos on the channel of where you can fish. We've got mark guides and things like that. The Sea Angler magazine, there's online things like Hook Point, but I want to start mainly with the gear today. So I'm carrying, now this is a beach bag by Abu, because the rods you use for beach fishing are bigger, heavier, and particularly when conditions turn for the worst, that it looks like they're going to do soon, you need to carry the bigger rods. I've got a rod rest in there, which is pretty much essential for beach fishing. Normally on the channel, we look at lure fishing, which is that little lure rod there. And I've just brought that little rod as a second rod, just in case we see anything here swimming in the surf. I can throw a little lure out, little plastic lure like that. But that's not what we're here for today. We're here for today to look at this beach setup and go right from the start as if you've never fished before. So I hope you carry on watching and we'll go through a few bits when you want to go sea fishing for the first time. So this is the beach box. I put everything in here. Obviously it's got the advantage of it stays nice and dry. You can bait up on it. You can get attachments here as well. You've got to bear in mind tides when you're sea fishing. Today we've got a tide which is flooding, or we call it flooding tide, which means it's coming in. So obviously I don't want to set up down here only to have to bring everything back up as the tide comes in. So it's worth looking out for some of these natural ledges here. These are the high tide marks, and there's a few of those. And then the rod rest here, you can see it's got like a space for two rods there. You just turn that, you're going to sit a rod in there and a rod in there. And then down the bottom here, you've got two cups to sit the butt of the rod. The bottom bit of the rod goes into those cups. So it just unscrews, obviously, just to transport it. But for now, we want a butt of the rod in there. And if you're using two rods, I'd put another butt in there as well. And obviously, if this is sand and things like that, you're keeping the rod up nice and high. And there are situations where you want your rod quite high, and those come into play. Rod in there, and a rod in there. So I brought two rods to show you today. These are beach rods. This is the Daiwa Kenzaki, and we did a review of that. I'll put a link up there. It's a 200 pound rod, but it's excellent, really excellent. And it's good for those various conditions that you have on the British coastline. So I don't know where you are in the coastline, perhaps let us know underneath. It'd be interesting to know. But generally, particularly for beaches off the south coast, this will also cope with some of those rock marks, deeper rock marks to the west, northwest of the country as well, and for distance casting towards the east. But we'll come on to different places to fish and I'll show you some links of where you could go. So there we go, we'll set this one up. And what it has, is a female spigot, which is on the butt end there. Chipped it a little bit as well. You should look after your rods, not that I do. And on the other end there, it has a male spigot that obviously goes into there. It's quite a tight fit on this particular rod, but you do have a grip here to push the two rods together. And it's worth wiping that section. You can do that with a cloth just to make sure there's no sort of bits of salt or grit in there, and then the same for the female section as well. If you've got bits of sand and stuff in there, it can end up wearing away the carbon a bit quicker, or even worse, cracking it during the cast. So We've wiped that, and it's sort of you push and twist, push and twist, and then you line up the rod rings. These are rod rings, and you're going to put the line through there. So obviously when you cast, you want that to be dead straight all the way along. I don't know if I can show you. And you want that to be dead straight, so the line goes through there all the way to the tip. So this has got 8 rod rings on it, and it's slightly different to another rod I'm going to show you in a minute. But let's get this one in. It's always good to get a bait in, and we'll go from there. Right, this is the reel, and this is known as a multiplier reel. And it's not the best bet for a beginner, really. You want to be looking at what's called a fixed spool reel. A fixed spool reel, which is one of those. Again, a little bit battered. And there's a reason for that. But I wanted to show you, and it has a lot of benefits, even if there's a bit of a learning curve, to be able to handle the casting on it. This is a very good example of a good reel. The Pen 525 mag, which we put in. And we've done a video of that there. I'll put that on the links if you want to have a look at that one. But let's show you how to put that on. This is a sliding reel seat, and the reel goes on there. And when you tighten up using that collar, it tightens the actual reel seat to the blank of the rod. You often hear the word blank referred to. This is the blank of the rod. And it goes on, you've got those two. When we look at the other rod, I'll show you the casting positions and how far you want that reel up. But for this one here, I'm just giving you a little bit of an insight into a bit further on in sea fishing. So you can see you've got really thick line on here. This goes to about, I think it's 60 pound line, but it's a tapered leader. So the more line you pull off, and that's going up past those rod rings, it gets thinner and thinner. And the reason for that is that you're going to join it to the main line, where you've got two types of line that are the same sort of diameter, in this case 15 pounds and under 32 mil. So we drag this off. So on the end of that is the tapered leader, and you can see, I'll pull it off for you actually. And then there's a knot on there that ties the thicker line, it's the line on the left, with that thinner line, the main line of the spool. And you can see here, it's a little bit tangled, so I'm better off doing a practice cast first, which is something you'll find yourself doing with a multiplier, less so with that fixed spool we looked at earlier. I use like a cheaper ASSO tapered shock leader. Same again, you want to match that spool up there. The line's going to come off here and over to that first rod eye up there. So the line that comes off the rod tip, you just wound that through. I tend to put one of these on. So we've got a few rigs here. You can keep them on these little floaty spool things. It's quite handy, particularly after the session. And we're going to use a rig here that's called a three hook flapper. Now you can buy these in shops, you can make them yourself. Again, we've got lots of rig time videos on the channel if you want to check them out. And we're going to put lugworm on these hooks. These are size 1 hooks, and we'll put a weight on one end of this and tie the other end onto that clip. So you can see there on the other end is this swivel. This is like a 150 pound swivel, and we're going to put that end onto the end of our rod. And then when you look all the way through here, this has got 3 hooks, flap around on a little snood. The weight goes onto one of those links.
So that's the lead we need. This is a grit breakaway lead. When that smashes into the water, that little blue thing pushes up and the bottom hook, which is on there, gets released, gets flipped out of there. That's the idea anyway. And I've had a look at the conditions today and I know that this is the correct weight for the sort of tide we've got going and the wind conditions, and be able to hold bottom, which means that will stay in the shingle. The idea is that that lead sits in the shingle there, and then these hooks sit off the bottom, and it's easy enough for the fish to hook itself. And you don't grab it like that, you don't strike in sea fishing really, use the tide to hook the fish. Hook is swallowed by the fish, that's the idea. So we're off to whiting today, and that tide is coming in pretty quick, so let's get a bait in. And something different about these are actually salted lugworms, so they're frozen. It's actually quite hard for the diggers at the moment, the tides aren't too big, so they're not the spring tides, and they're not getting fresh lugworm, very hard to get. So these have sort of been salted, but they've been salted whilst they're still quite fresh. These are actually from Tony's Tackle in Eastbourne, and they're a really good second best to live bait. I had a really good session using these sort of worms for Plaice, where we landed 8 of them. You can see there in the video there, we got a lot of Plaice on these. I really do rate them, and that's probably a good little tip, especially if you want to keep bait in the freezer. And these will actually stay quite fresh in your tackle box as well. So different to putting on a live worm today, but I'll show you how to thread these up nice and clean. So you're going to put the worm through the middle, the hook's going to go through the middle. And you're sort of pinching it round so the point of the hook doesn't break through the worm. And this sort of theory is the same with the fresh worms as well. And then when you get to the point, you can actually move some with your thumb up, some down there. You can use bait elastic, but these are quite firm, they'll survive a first cast. And the worm's going to sit like that on all three hooks, so we've got three hooks to do. And then we'll take a look at how to cast this in. You see the point of the hook is always out of the bait. You don't want to mask that by gumming it up with all the lugworm. Now what I've done here, it's got like a little stopper there. You see the stopper on the line? And a sequin. I'll just push that down, it stops that worm. So as I was saying, I want to do a little practice cast for this. All I'm doing is swinging the lead out until it drops down a little bit. Make sure that it's there. Retrieving in, I've cast this side of me. Retrieving in, I'm going under my left arm. When you retrieve it back in, all of that's got to be nice, nice and straight.
So that's our position, we're in our elevated position. Tide's come in, I took so long setting up. Just wanted to show you the basics there. We've got three lugworms out on that with a weight, but we need to do something with this rod now. So I'm reeling in the slack, it's down tide, reeling in the slack, and I'm feeling for that tension. I'm feeling for the tension where the lead is stuck on the bottom, you know, what we showed earlier, where it was on the shingle. So you can almost get a good bend in the rod. I know that is going to tighten up without popping out. So it's quite high in the air there. Bring that down, and that's it. That's quite set now. So that's set, ready to catch. So there we go, a basic beach set up with a lugworm on there using a multiplier reel. Now I'm going to hand over to Brian Pask to show you a little bit more detail of how you want to cast for the first time from the beach. It's always best to try and get a coach to talk you through it if you can. But this is a good second best with Brian. He's a good coach. I'll just show you the basic cast to get us started.
What we're going to do this week is just give you a quick demonstration of basic casting and then move on to slightly more advanced. So what we're going to do then is you've got your reel fully spooled up, as we said in previous blogs, with a shock leader on the front end. So it's gripping the reel, releasing the bail arm, and the arm position is pretty much parallel, but with your arms behind and away from your body. The release point when you're coming up and over will be as the rod passes your right ear. So here we go then, guys, and away it goes. What we're going to do is just run through a very basic overhead thump cast. Starting position, just get your feet slightly apart. Make sure you're nice and sturdy, because the last thing you want to do is actually fall over. Release the bail arm, holding the line with your index finger. Arm position, so. What we're actually going to do is get this cast over the head, but release point off your finger as it's coming past your right ear. So here we go, guys, and away it goes. Okay, guys, we're going to move over from the basic overhead thump cast and put a little bit more into it without the use of any additional power, really. It really does involve moving the lead nearer to your feet to start with, and I'm actually using a tennis ball so you can see it easier. So in it's coming, and it's going to be laying down inside the arc of the rod. The rod tip laid right down low, the butt up high. The reason for that is you're moving the rod tip the furthest possible distance it can go, and you're also going to be able to pull down with your left hand to apply additional pressure. The lead's inside the tip of the rod because you're going to bend the rod from the second it starts moving. And that way you're going to get more bend into the rod, which is going to power the lead further away.
This is what Brian was talking about with a fixed spool reel. You just clip the bail arm over, make sure that's locked over, and then holding the line under tension. Well, we're using mono today, but if you're using braid, it's well worth getting a finger stool. I'll leave details of that in the description.
Can pinch a little bit off there as well. And that is it, it's ready to go. But there is a slight difference with this next setup. So this is a cascade rig, this next one. Works slightly differently to the flapper in that you clip the bait on. So you're actually taking the first lugworm off that swivel there. It's got that little hook there. You take the lugworm down to the hook and you clip that on there. And then further down the rig is another line. The line that's coming off is called a snood. And then on the bottom snood, you're attaching it to that leg clip on there. So I'll put a link underneath of how to tie a rig like this. Cascade swivel is really good. It keeps everything nice and neat. And then you just hook that onto there, and the whole thing falls apart when you cast and that hits the water.
But if you're a real beginner, but to make things easier on you, a fixed spool reel, these fixed spool reels are a lot easier to cast and fish with to start off with. And this rod's going to be a continental rod. You can see it's a lot thinner in the tip there. This is a Colmic Lunar Surf. Really good rod, you can cast really far with it. But it's a little bit lighter, it's a little bit more, it's got a lot more feeling in the tip. So you'll feel those smaller fish. Not quite as much backbone as the Daiwa. This is a 4.5 meter rod, and we're going to put the fixed spool on it. And it's got a set position there. It's got a set position there on the reel seat. So we'll set this one up. So hopefully that's enough to get you started fishing in the sea for the first time. As always, if you can pop into your local tackle shop, that's a really good option to look at some of the sea fishing gear there. And although we didn't catch anything on this short session that I did for you, there is the potential in the seas around Britain of catching some good fish. This is us catching some plaice down near Eastbourne last autumn. Now, thanks very much for watching. If you've got any beginner questions, then do stick them here. Any comments or anything you can help out beginners with, I'd love to see your comments underneath. Thanks again for watching.